there's been a sharp rise in populism throughout Western democracies, both in North America, but also in Europe. This rise in populism is often talked about in two ways. On the one hand, there's the view that cultural factors, loss of identity, concerns about immigration and loss of culture are really driving voters towards supporting populists and away from more establishment parties. The other view is that economics, in some shape or form, plays a role, either through increased import competition that displaces workers, or because of poor economic outcomes due to, for example, the financial crisis. Now, one interesting observation is that the rise of populism in Europe and North America has come after the global financial crisis. I'm Emil Verner, and I'm an assistant professor at MIT's Sloan School of Management. A lot of my work essentially focuses on the connection between credit markets and business cycles, and argues that credit markets play an important role in actually driving and amplifying business cycles. So in a 2017 paper with Atif Mian and Amr Sufi, what we looked at was the connection between credit cycles or credit expansions, that is, expansions in lending to the private sector. And what we found is that expansions in lending, especially to households or to consumers, are associated with short-run booms, so short-run good economic times, but then subsequent slowdowns in economic growth. So essentially, they bring these credit expansions bring short-term gains, but long-term, medium to long-term subsequent slowdowns in growth. And this is quite a robust pattern that you find across a number of both advanced and emerging market economies. It's actually, if you think about the cycle in the 2000s in the United States, it's actually somewhat representative of what happens, what tends to happen during credit cycles, these credit expansions. So something will happen, there'll be some shift, and what we argue is that there's an expansion in credit supply, in the willingness of lenders essentially to extend credit or extend more credit on cheaper terms. And this expansion in credit supply drives an expansion in lending for about three, four, five years. So think in the United States from 2002 to 2005, 2006, there was a period of rapid growth in credit, especially to households. And that's when growth is good. So that's sort of the short run gains of credit expansion. And then that's followed by three, 4 years down the road, slowdowns in growth. So think sort of the slowdown in growth that we saw in the United States from 2007 to 2010, 11, 12. And this pattern turns out to be much more general. So expansions in credit over 3 to 4 years are associated with good growth for those 3 to 4 years, and then subsequent contractions for the next 3 to 4 years as well. So this is sort of a relatively long cycle. It's not something that happens just within a year, but something that happens over sort of, 3 years on the upside and then 3 to 4 years on the downside as well. One thing that I just want to highlight is that these expansions or these patterns hold mostly for credit to households or credit to consumers. When we look at credit to businesses, so think lending to agricultural firms or manufacturing firms, we don't find the same boom and bust patterns in the data. So there's something special about credit to households, or at least there's something different about different forms of credit. And that's some of what our work has looked at. So what are the causes of these expansions? Well, first, we argue that you can think about these expansions as being driven by two things, either an increase in demand for credit. So borrowers may want to borrow more, maybe because they think that their income is going to be higher in the future. Or it could be driven by an increase in credit supply, that is, by an increase in the willingness of lenders to extend credit, potentially to less creditworthy borrowers. And what the key pattern in the data that we see is that during these credit expansions, credit spreads or the price of credit tend to be compressed or tend to be very low. So that suggests that during these credit expansions, actually credit, if anything, is getting cheaper, which points to an increase in the supply of credit as driving these credit cycles. Now, this expansion in the supply of credit, it could be driven by correct beliefs, but it could also be driven by over-optimistic beliefs, either on the part of borrowers or on the part of lenders. Now, disentangling these two sides of the story is difficult, but we do have some evidence from other survey research that shows that lenders tend to become quite over-optimistic during credit expansion. So they tend to over-extrapolate how well borrowers are going to be able to do in terms of repaying their loans, in terms of servicing their loans. And often, those optimistic expectations turned out not to be justified in terms of subsequent outcomes. So during these credit expansions, there does tend to be over-optimistic sentiment among market participants in credit markets and in the wider economy. To a large extent, the lenders are to blame, but I think that borrowers often requires two to tango in some sense, and often borrowers also will have over-optimistic beliefs about their, their ability to service those debts as well. But yes, the credit supply story this idea that the expansion in credit is driven by an increase in credit supply really does suggest that lenders are the ones who play a key role in terms of being too optimistic in their willingness to extend credit. We typically think of devaluations as being a way to stabilize in the face of negative shocks. So small open economies that have flexible exchange rates can actually devalue their exchange rates, making their exports more competitive. But this has an important caveat if there's widespread foreign currency borrowing in the economy. The type of foreign currency borrowing is also very important. So for example, firms borrowing in foreign currency in lots of emerging markets, including Hungary, but also in Latin America, many of these firms tend to borrow in foreign currency for good reason. They tend to borrow in foreign currency because they're exporting, and therefore they're matching their export revenues with their debt payments. But households very often don't have foreign currency income receipts. So when they borrow in foreign currency, they're exposing themselves to a risk that many firms are not exposing themselves to. And so what happens during these devaluations is that even though there's positive benefits of the devaluation in terms of improved export competitiveness, it also leads to a sharp deterioration of the local economy if there's widespread foreign currency debt, especially in the household sector, because of the severe negative effects on local demand and on household financial conditions when households have these debts in foreign currency. There's been a sharp rise in populism throughout Western democracies, both in North America, but also in Europe. And this rise in populism is often talked about in two ways. On the one hand, there's the view that cultural factors, loss of identity, concerns about immigration and loss of culture are really driving voters towards supporting populists and away from more establishment parties. The other view is that economics in some shape or form plays a role, either through increased import competition that displaces workers or because of poor economic outcomes due to, for example, the financial crisis. Now, one interesting observation is that the rise of populism in Europe and North America has come after the global financial crisis. And so that suggests that there might be some link between the two. Focusing specifically on the case of Hungary, what we found is that actually the households that experienced the crisis most severely, in particular the households that had debts denominated in foreign currency, were substantially more likely to switch from voting for establishment parties toward right-wing populist parties that were offering much more aggressive pro-debtor, anti-creditor policies in order to alleviate the crisis for these households. So that suggests that the financial crisis actually played a key role in terms of driving many households, not all voters, but some voters, toward supporting anti-establishment, right-wing populist parties because those parties offered more aggressive solutions to the financial crisis. And what's interesting here is that exploiting a financial crisis from the perspective of a populist party actually connects nicely or dovetails well with populists' claim to speak for the people against some outside threat or against the elite, and that's exactly what you saw in Hungary. That ordinary people experienced distress through their foreign currency debts. That was, the populists argued, brought about by foreign banks coming in and providing these quite risky loans without necessarily divulging all of the risks to these borrowers. And when distress happened, the populists were essentially able to exploit this anti-elite sentiment, this anti-finance sentiment as well, and corral voters through these very pro-debtor, anti-creditor type of policies, which are policies that are actually not necessarily a bad idea. So I think you can argue that some of the policies that populists are suggesting, in particular with dealing with distress and the fallout after financial crises, in terms of providing a more equitable solution to the crisis, in terms of which groups bear the burden of adjusting to the crisis, is actually quite reasonable. If you look at credit market conditions right now, you're not seeing the type of over-exuberant sentiment, the types of credit expansions that we saw in the 2000s. So that points to the fact that in the short term, it seems unlikely that there would be a financial crisis that would bring about the type of distress that you saw both in Europe, in emerging Europe, in the United States in 2008. But of course, in the medium to long term, history tells us we're always going to have financial crises. They will look slightly different, but often will play out in the same forms. And it's very difficult to guard against these sorts of crises from happening for a variety of reasons, both because of our understanding of them is somewhat limited, but also because of political economy forces that push away from doing sufficient regulation of the financial system that would be required to prevent these crises. So in the long term, I'm not optimistic about our ability to prevent crises in the future, and also to prevent some of the negative fallouts from crises, both in terms of the economic distress that they cause, but also the increased political polarization, the political fallout that financial crises often bring.